So there's these questions we all ask, big questions that have a huge effect on our lives. But there's all this information out there that makes finding a solution difficult. So we came up with a better way to give you the answers that you need. We did a survey at Easter and compiled a list of your top 6 most asked questions. That list then became a roadmap for this message series. Each week, we'll examine a single question and discover God's answers based on His Word. It's a series we like to call You Asked For It.
All right, we are continuing with our series. Today is week number 4 with You Asked For It. And again, we took a survey during Easter and asked you the top things you wanted to hear about. And what we do, we compiled the list together. We've been going through them. And so this we're dealing with something called dealing with disappointment. I want to encourage you and invite folks to come. There's connection card. Invite cards. As you leave, you'll see them on a little table there. Take them and invite folks to come. Next week, we're going to be talking about heaven. What about heaven? What does the Bible say about heaven? Is it really a place? Is there a place called hell? We're going to talk about that next week. And then the following week, you've asked us the questions about the LGBT community. How are we to respond to them? And so I was going to do a message on it myself, but I found a wonderful woman named Patty Height who has a ministry called Out of Egypt, and she'll be sharing her story of living that lifestyle for over 20 years when she thought she was a boy growing up. I mean, she went through the whole thing. And so who better than someone that went through it to describe how it's like, how she got free, how she's walking in freedom in Christ. And I guarantee you, we're not going to beat anyone up. We're going to show the life and the love of Jesus Christ and how He loves every person and desires for every person to walk in freedom. That will be the 16th. And then we have David Wagner. So a jam-packed couple of weeks. Really want to encourage you to come. Next week, heaven. The following week is LGBT community. And people say, should my children be here? You know what? Your children are going to hear about it out in the world, everywhere they go. They're putting in cartoons now and every place. So what better place to hear it than in a church? So I want to encourage you, you know what? We can't put our head in the sand. We're living in the real world. And why not confront it with the truth? And so that's what's going to be happening. Okay, everybody? I'm really excited about that. Well, today we're talking about dealing with disappointment. How many of you guys have ever dealt with disappointment? Oh, it's fun, isn't it? Isn't it fun to be disappointed? I was really disappointed, as I shared earlier. You know, I thought maybe the Yankees would have a chance. Maybe by a miracle. Jose Sanchez is doing an amazing job. Gary Sanchez, thank you. I just threw the Jose because he's Spanish. I thought that would make a lot of sense. Gary Sanchez hitting 20 home runs. He just got this rookie up. Think Yankees are doing. All of a sudden, they started falling apart, and they swept the Boston Red Sox. C.C. Sabathia struck out David Ortiz, Big Papa. And we're sitting there looking at the scoreboard. Toronto, please beat Baltimore. And what happened was the Yankees lost. No, the Yankees won, excuse me. The Yankees win 3 games in a row, but Baltimore beat the Toronto Blue Jays, which eliminated the Yankees from the wild card. And so I was disappointed. I got to wait till next year. All the way to next year. And I don't even want to watch it anymore, you know. But we struck out Big Papi. And I'm really excited he's retiring. But anyhow, now back to what I was talking about. That's a disappointment on a low level, is it not? Disappointment that your DVR didn't record the program because the kids wanted to watch something else. Does that anybody? Disappointment that your battery runs out. Okay, those are small things. How about this? Disappointed that the marriage you prayed and hoped for fell apart. Disappointed that the parent that you loved died of a horrible disease. Disappointed that the job you always hoped for and wanted you lost. Disappointed that you thought God had your back and you thought things were going to go well in your life and they have not gone well. Disappointed that you just can't seem to make ends meet. Disappointed that you try to get into a school and you can't get into the school. You don't know what God's calling you to do. You're kind of lost about it. Disappointment, your car keeps breaking down and it seems the bills are piling up and your ability to pay the bills is not, and you're getting overwhelmed with bills. And sometimes you get so many bills, you want to take pills. There's so many bills. You know what I'm talking about? You got these various things, disappointed, and perhaps the worst thing to be disappointed next to is being disappointed with yourself. Well, you thought, by the time I'm 25, I'm going to be here. By the time I'm 40, I should be here. By the time I'm 65, I should be able to retire. And all those things you hope for, you dream for, you're disappointed that you did not reach what you expected. And after a while, the disappointments kind of gather, don't they? Well, in many ways, What is going on here? Hang on. You get to see the magic behind the curtain. Da-da-da-da. Okay. Come on. There we go. We'll try it again. Please work. I'm really disappointed. I know the problem. My son figured it out because he's so smart. I'm at the end of the slideshow. Oh, it's a long show. You're going to be disappointed with that. Okay, let's try it again. Okay. All right. See, this is what happens. You know, you think that you can. I'm disappointed that this is not working like it should because I didn't do what my son said. And there we go. If the sun sets you free, you should be free indeed, right? Okay. Let's try that again. Ah, there we go. Thank you. Isn't that great? See? Now, if you were not here, I'd be kicking the TV and yelling at it. No, I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding. Can I be honest with you for a second? No, I shouldn't be. All right. Do you realize that one time someone was trying to get out of this parking lot and they couldn't get out in time and someone cut them off? And you can only imagine what happened. Okay. That's not good. I was disappointed. All right. Assassins of hope. What's an assassins of hope? You know, if you think about it in many ways, we live in a world that's not, it's kind of hostile at times, isn't it? Imagine yourself being in the middle of the ocean and you're in a raft. And this raft is filled with air. And it seems like there's like these assassins of help where disappointments are like assassins of help. Imagine two ships out there and it seems like a cannonball comes at you and hits the bow of your ship and you get on the hole there and you have to patch it. And it seems like these disappointments come. You try to repair it in time and it's just like these cannonballs of disappointment keep on hitting you. And after a while, you're afraid, am I going to sink? And then you're hit so often and sit so bad that eventually you're in a lifeboat that's full of air. And you feel like, I got to float through this. I don't think I can. I don't know if you've ever felt that way emotionally or felt that way in your life where these assassins of hope come. We talked about losing your job, your health. How about this? Being disappointed with God. Have you ever been disappointed with God? Or as Rick said, God, where are you? I remember there was a time in my life, like, God, where are you, God? Did you change the door? Did you change your phone number? Did you change the locks? I can't have access to you anymore. There was a time in my life where I didn't feel God or believe God even existed. Maybe that's you today. Assassins of hope come and they shoot at us, trying to discourage us. Disappointments. That's what happens. Disappointments in life. Now, what's a disappointment? Well, a disappointment, if you think about it, an appointment that are dissed, okay? Appointments that are messed up, they're dissed. You know, you have an appointment. You're thinking that by time you're this age, that your children, by time they reached 5 years old, will be making their beds and everything else. And you're thinking that by time you are 65, you have these appointments. You're thinking that this is going to happen. On an appointed time, it's going to go better for me. And then the appointed time comes, and you're disappointed. And so that's what happens. We have goals, we have expectations, and our expectations are not met. And so we are disappointed because we didn't make the appointment that we thought we'd have. Well, this is what we often go through. And so disappointment, it's huge. It happens to all of us. And you're kind of hoping that I could kind of get rid of disappointment. I don't like disappointment. I want to get rid of disappointment. How do I get rid of disappointments? I don't like them. I don't want them. I want to move on. In fact, I'm going to try my very best to avoid them. I got good news and bad news. Here's the bad news. Jesus told us something. That's bad news? Well, listen to me. Hold on. And this is from the Message, by the way. Jesus says, I'll tell the verse in its original, well, not original. Original language in Greek, but as we translate it to NIV or NASAB, would be this. I've told you all this, so trusting me, you will be unshaken. In this world, Jesus says, you will have trouble. But rejoice, I've overcome the world. I like what Eugene Peterson says, and I think he does a good job, by the way. He's a scholar, he's a Greek scholar, and he does a good way of breaking it down, I think, in our language today. This is what he says. This is the same verse. I've told you all this so that trusting me, you will be unshakable. and assured and deeply at peace. How many of you would like to be unshakable, assured, and deeply at peace? Am I the only person here that wants that? I want that, right? Who doesn't want that? I mean, isn't that awesome? Unshakable, assured, and deeply at peace. In this godless world, you will continue to experience difficulties. Okay? Listen, I think one of the major things we can get off the table right now and help us all, guys, this is not heaven. Look at your neighbor and say, this is not heaven. But this church is pretty good. I'm just kidding. Okay? This is not heaven. And if you expect heaven to be here, it's not going to be here. Totally. And so we have to change our expectations, which is we talked about in our series called Overwhelm, which I encourage you to go to. We dealt with some of these issues. In this godless world, you'll continue to experience difficulties, but take heart, I've conquered the world. That Jesus has conquered the world. Yeah, if he conquered the world, why did I lose my mother? Why did I lose my marriage? Why did I lose my job? Why did I struggle with all these things? If God really conquered the world, you guys talk about all this conquering stuff. We're more than conquerors through Christ Jesus. Well, I feel like I'm conquered. In fact, I think God's forgotten me. And if that's you today, I'm sure some of us are feeling that way. Listen, I encourage you that God has never left you, nor will he ever leave you. He's always with you if you call on him. But I don't feel him. We're going to talk about that today. I like what James says. And this is, again, another verse you might have heard if you're in a church for a period of time. It says this, dear brothers and sisters, when troubles of any kinds come your way, consider it an opportunity for great joy. How many folks you know that way? Oh, praise God, I crashed my car. I'm so excited I get to go in a rental car. Praise God, I stubbed my toe in the middle of the night. You know anyone like that? You know people like that? They're just saying, oh, praise God. Bless them, thank them, lift your hands, praise them. Never forget, I was going through a real difficult time in my life, and a relationship was just destroyed, and it broke my heart. And I said, praise God, put praise and worship on, lift your hands. I'm like, shut up. You have no idea what I'm going through. Be quiet. Sometimes the best thing to do when someone's going through a hard time is, guess what, to say nothing. Consider it an opportunity for great joy when things go bad. Surely you're missing this. That's crazy. For you know that when your faith is tested, your endurance has a chance to grow. Oh, please. I don't want to go through this, God. So let it grow. For when your endurance is fully developed, you will be perfect and complete, needing nothing. That sounds like a pretty good deal here. But, you know, I have a sneaky suspicion that most of us in our lives have found that the greatest growth in our lives has come during perfect times, right? Nope. My greatest growth has come during difficult times. In fact, it's just the nature of life. When you go to the gym, what do you got to do? You got to break. I know I told you before, I work out a lot. You can tell. Okay? When you go to the gym, what do you got to do? You got to break down your muscles to the point of failure so they can grow. If you don't give your muscles enough resistance, they will not grow. If you don't have enough resistance in your life, chances are you're not going to grow. It has to break down before it grows. And so what the Bible's saying here, consider a great joy. Well, how can you do that? That sounds crazy. How are you supposed to consider a great joy when things go bad? We'll bring that in context here. And there's another verse I want to bring to your attention about this whole issue. But the first thing is this, that the Bible tells us to change what you normally would want to do. Normally you want to complain. But instead of complaining, you rejoice because this is an opportunity for you to grow. Thanks. Thanks a lot. I don't like these opportunities to grow. I'd rather just have peace. I don't need this, God. I really don't need it. I don't need the situation taking place right now. So let it grow. When your endurance is fully developed, you'll be perfect and complete, needing nothing. Consider it an opportunity for great joy. We're going to look at this, and how can it possibly be an opportunity for great joy? And then, like it says in Romans 8:28, you've probably heard this verse, very famous. A lot of us have us on our mirrors, and we memorized it, and we pulled out, we listened to it, and we know that God causes everything to work together for good for those who love God and are called according to his purposes for them. Praise God! She was a prostitute, and now she has a home for unwed mothers. It was God's will that she was a prostitute. No, it wasn't. Yes, it was. No, it wasn't. Praise God, they started a drug rehab. He used to be a heroin addict. Isn't that awesome? No, God didn't want him to be a heroin addict. What do you mean? Doesn't God want these things to happen? You know, I fell into sin so God could use me. That's what he wanted to do. He wanted my marriage to fail so it could help others that were going through difficult times, right? God, you know, he took my child away so I could help people that lose their child. You know, God needs another angel in heaven. Don't say stuff like that. No, God doesn't cause those things to happen. The Bible doesn't say that. God causes everything, says, to work together for good. You see, God is the master of raising dead things. In fact, Jesus, on his way to his friend's house, Mary, Martha, and Lazarus, if you remember the story, if you don't, that's okay. Lazarus died, 4 days dead. Jesus knows he's going to raise him from the dead. Jesus goes to Martha and Mary's house. We're on the way to go to the funeral. And he actually, the Bible says he cried. People say he cried because of their lack of faith. I don't think so. It says he wept. Why? Because he saw the pain and he saw the death of this world. And he saw the pain that it had. And he identified with the pain. Listen, God identifies with the pain. Even though he knows Lazarus is going to rise up again. You see, God is a perfect person, but takes the dead things in your life and can make them come alive and bring them to life. It's not God's will for people to go through all these horrible things, but God can take your mess and make a message out of it. God can take your failure and use it for fertilizer to grow you, yes. But it's not his purpose is not for you to fall into sin so you have a testimony. Does that make sense, everybody? That's just wrong theology to think God brings us up on us so he can grow us. No, he allows it, yes. We live in a fallen world. And so what we're going to do is we're going to look at Romans 8:28, and we're going to look at it, what surrounds it. You see, real estate agents will tell you all the time that the price of the home is based upon what? Location, location, location. We got to be careful. We don't just pull scriptures out by themselves without understanding the context of before and after. If we don't do that, we can make scripture say anything. So it's important to look at the context. This is one of the most powerful verses in scripture, and we're going to look at the entire chapter today and how it's going to do it, okay? We're going to look at it. So basically, if you look at this verse, this is a good way to look at it. In Christ, your bad things turn out for good, even though he didn't want it to happen. Your bad stuff turns out for good. And your good things cannot be lost. And your best things are yet to come. That's pretty much what this verse means, impartially. So let's look at it here. Our bad things turn out for good. Okay, please understand, God doesn't want these bad things to happen to you, but he's the master of making the bad things turn for good. So no matter what you're going through, God somehow, I'm waiting to see God redeem this to a good way. And so what has to happen, we have to look for that redemption. We have to ask God for that redemption. And even though it's difficult, God, I don't understand what's going on right now, but I thank you that you're going to turn it for good. If because I love you, I'm going to trust you with it. I'm going to look for the avenue of help. I'm going to look for the opportunity to grow. God, I told God this. God, right now I'm in the middle of lemonade. I'm going to squeeze this lemon till the rinds fall apart. I want to learn every lesson I can during this difficult time because, frankly, I don't want to go through it again, God. And this is what happens. This is a good translation of that, taking the original language and breaking it up. For those loving him, God works together all things for good. Okay, that's what the scripture says. He doesn't cause these things to happen, but if they do happen, he will help you and I. And so I love what the Bible says about this. It says, for all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. So you have not received a spirit that makes you fearful slaves. I want to share a story with you of a tremendous man I met when I was in seminary, my second year in our class on missions. I met a man by the name of Prani Prasen. He was probably in his late 70s, early 80s, and he was a missionary to Nepal during the 50s and 60s. And let me tell you, Nepal during those times, which is, by the way, by China, it's where Mount Everest is in that area. It is a mountainous region and very hostile to the gospel of Jesus Christ. You'd be killed and martyred in that country during those times. It was horrible. And he became a missionary to that. And God called him to go. It was a divine call. And Prani went to Nepal, and he started preaching the gospel, and people were giving their lives to Christ. Miracles were taking place, he said. Blind eyes were opening. Deaf ears were opening. People were giving their lives to Christ. People were being healed. It was an amazing thing. It was tremendous success. And he was excited about things are going well. How many of you have been through that in your life? Things are going good, and it seems like God's really answering all the questions and all the things you want. So we're going to be sharing about the story of Prani Prasad today as we illustrate these points, okay? So for all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. If you're led by the Spirit of God, you're children of God. So you have not received a spirit that makes you fearful slaves. Instead, you receive God's Spirit when he's adopted you as his own children. Now we call him Abba. Listen, this is so important. If you are giving your life to Jesus Christ, the Bible says he's your daddy. Remember we talked in the Lord's Prayer? He's called Abba, which means daddy God. What an amazing thing. Hey, God, you're my daddy, right? Abba, Father, for his spirit joins with our spirit to affirm that we're God's children. A lot of people say what we got to do is you have to discover the God in you. And so I'm going to do some stretching exercises and go to a place of nothing, and go to nothing and find that God in me. Well, you know, if you think of nothing and try to be nothing, guess what you get? Nothing. Or you worry. No, you see, a lot of the world religions and philosophies have a lot of truth in them, but they have lies. The greatest lies have the greatest amount of truth. So Buddhism, detachment is the answer to Buddhism. I want to detach myself from anything that can cause me disappointment. Therefore, I won't be disappointed. And so there's partial truth in that, that we can't look to our sustenance and our happiness based upon this planet alone. So they get that, but look in, look in. Luke, look in. Okay, I'm sorry, my son's Luke, and the movie's coming out. Look in. Well, I've looked in. I don't like what I see. And the problem is, you see, God has not called us to have a cistern. You know what a cistern is? A cistern would be a place like a well, if you will, that just has water. A cistern would be a place that you just have water. And God has not called it. Jesus says, out of your innermost being will flow rivers of living water. You see, God has an underground spring that's flying through your bottom of your spirit. And what we need to do is get that well, and it's called the Spirit of God, gets installed, and we can dip into that area and get that fresh water. And that water will help bring life to the areas of our life. And so the issue is getting God that's in us. By giving our life to Christ, we receive the Holy Spirit. Now our objective is to get God in us. The Bible says in Philippians, work out your salvation. Well, you work out what God has worked in. So we got God inside of it. We want to work him out. You see that? All right, so you've not received the Spirit that makes you fearful to slaves. But Abba, Father, for his spirit joins with our spirit. Do you see that? His spirit joins with our spirit. This is why you can find God in you. You're not God, but you can find God in you if you give your life to Jesus Christ. There is a supernatural impartation of the Holy Spirit in you to affirm that we are God's children. Okay, that's huge and very, very important to understand. And since we are his children, we are heirs, which means we have rights and privileges as children of God. Together with Christ, we are heirs of God's glory. But we are to, and this is the part I don't like too much, but if we are to share his glory, we also must share his? I don't know about you, but I would like to get rid of that. And I just want our church to focus on one thing. But we're going to share in the glory of God. We're going to preach every week about entering the glory of God, right? That's the glory of God. I don't want to talk about the sufferings. Do you? I don't want the sufferings. But the Bible says, but if we are to share his glory, we must also share his sufferings. Yet what we suffer now is nothing compared to the glory he will reveal to us later. You know what this is called? Delayed gratification. Something we have to teach children, and something, frankly, we have to teach ourselves, right? I want it now. I want dessert now. I don't want to wait. I want it now. Microwave ovens are for now. Nothing tastes good in a microwave oven. Have you noticed that? Makes meat rubbery. The best way is when it's cooked thoroughly. Listen, we want it now, but God wants us to wait. Delayed gratification. You see, the whole world pretty much wants to have happiness. They want to have meaningful relationships. And so what happens is they shortcut it. Instead of doing it God's way, we take a shortcut, and that shortcut actually ends up doing us more damage. And so the Bible says here, we suffer now is nothing compared to the glory he will reveal to us later. So what's the later part? Heaven, we're going to talk about next week. For all creation is waiting eagerly for the future day when God will reveal who his children really are. Against its will, all creation was subjected to God's curse. You know what happened? Mankind, when we had the earth, the planet, everything is perfect. Listen, the fact that everyone says, there's got to be more. There's something not right with the planet, right? We all know that. There's something not right. The fact that you and I desire perfection is a testimony that God exists. Or else we wouldn't even want perfection. Why? Because there's a standard that's out there. That standard comes from God. We know something is not right. All creation groans. I hear about earthquakes. I think of the planet groaning for its redemption. You see, what happened was mankind was over the planet, and when man sinned, everything under man's authority was hurt. God really honors authority structure. That's why we need to be praying for our election process. God help us. Talk about disappointment. My Lord. It's so bad, isn't it? It's so bad, I think we should pray right now. So rather than complain, let's pray. Let's pray right now. Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we pray for the two candidates that are running for president of the United States. We pray for Hillary Clinton, and we pray for Donald Trump. Lord, we don't like what we're seeing. We don't like the attitude. We don't like the bickering. We don't like the fighting. We don't like all the trash talk. We don't like all the political maneuvering. But Father, we're asking that you'd bless Hillary Clinton and bless Donald Trump. Lord, that you would show yourself to these two people. Father, we pray for civility to come back to our country. We pray, Father God, that your church would not wag its finger and complain, but we would be the answer. Father, we're asking for the spirit of you to raise up in this country, Father, that, Lord, that you'd save America. And, Lord, we realize that the saving of America is Jesus Christ and that Jesus Christ comes through the church. And so, Lord, we pray for these candidates, God. We're asking that the truth will come out. And, Father, that we be able to vote with a clear conscience, knowing the differences between the candidates. And, Lord, we're praying more than anything else that the candidates would know you, Father. Both of them would come to know you. If they don't know you already, Lord, if they don't, they're sure not exhibiting the fruits of the Spirit. We're asking they would come to know you in Jesus' name. And, Father, I pray whoever the candidate is, whoever gets elected, we would back them and pray for them because you asked us to pray for those in authority. And so, Lord, we decide right now we're not going to give in to this hate. We're not going to give in to bickering. We're not going to give in to anger. We're going to pray that your will be done during this election. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, that's an example of what we should be doing when you hear these crazy reports. But I'll be praying all the time. Exactly. All right. For we know that all creation has been groaning as in the pains of childbirth, right up to its present time. I mean, a woman knows, right? Man, I'm walking different. I got pain. My husband has to get up all the time, and I wish it's hard for the husbands, but that's all right. And so, something's happening. There's a birthing pain. There's something. I know that something's coming. Listen, there's birth pangs, and the more pangs there are on the planet, the closer we are to the culmination of all history. The table's being set. We should be happy. You and I get to be in the last days. We get to make a difference. This is the time for heroes. And so the Bible goes on, and we believers also groan. Do we not groan? Oh, my arthritis. Oh, I can't see you close anymore. Even though we have the Holy Spirit within us, as a foretaste, you know, it's like putting something on layaway. You buy something. Maybe you put some money on a brand new car, and you keep going every week. They're going to hold it for you. You go every week, you look at it, you go inside, you smell the brand new leather, but it's not yours yet. Well, that's kind of what it's like now. Our believers, we also groan, even though we have the Holy Spirit within us as a foretaste. All the glory and the peace you feel is a foretaste of what God has for you. A future glory. For we long for our bodies to be released from sin. Do we not? The older you get, have you noticed, the older you get, the more you want to be released? We too wait in eager hope. Here's the huge thing, guys. I want you to hold this. Hope. How do you deal with disappointment? Hope is extraordinarily important. Franny Prossen was in prison, in Nepal prison. He got arrested finally because he was kept in sharing his faith. Thrown in prison, first time, dirt floors, rats gnawing you when you're sleeping, excrement all around, overpacked rooms. There's no TVs. There's no Olympic-sized swimming pools. None of that stuff. Three hots and a cot. None of that stuff happens. It's bad news over there. Bad. The prisons are bad. But somehow or another, he gets out and preaches the gospel again. And then he gets thrown in a second time. And he keeps on preaching the gospel. People give their lives to Christ. And the prison warden and the prison guards are infuriated with him, so angry with him. They said, that does it. We're going to throw you in the morgue. And so they threw Prani Prasin into a morgue. Now, this is not the nice morgues you see on this CSI and all that, where, you know, you go into the nice air-conditioned room, and you have these little file cabinets. You open it up. There's a little tag on someone's toe and a nice blue drape. No, this is an un-air-conditioned. They just go like this. Throw the body in, and guess what happens? It decomposes. Now, from my understanding, it's disgusting when a body decomposes. There's no putrid smell as worse as that. Sometimes they bury him, sometimes they die. You know what? Let's not worry about it. And they put Prani Prasin there, in that place. To make matters worse, there's no windows. It's in the basement, and they closed the door. He said to our class, I was overwhelmed with fear, anxiety, and like, God, where are you, God? And maybe once a day, a light would come on, and he'd see a little slit in the door, a little light would come on, they'd throw a plate of bread or some kind of beans or something, and maybe a cup of water. And he lived there. He's like, you sent me as a missionary here. You said that thousands would get saved. You sent me here, God. Where are you, God? What's going on, God? I'm in a dead place. And he was getting discouraged as time goes on. He began to lose hope. In many ways, the ship of his ministry was cannonballed to such a degree that he was now on the lifeboat. He was on the raft full of air. And as discouragement came, the smell of bodies, week one, week two, week three, and he began to lose air. And he began to find the waves of emotion were sweeping over him, began to gulp water of discouragement. How many of you have ever been there where it's like you just feel like you could barely float? You're wondering if you can even cope. The hope is being lost. The air of hope is leaving you. And the sea of discouragement is overtaking you. The Bible says we too wait with eager hope for the day when God will give us our full rights as his adopted children, including new bodies he's promised. We could go on about this. We were given this hope when we were saved. You see, hope is so important. You and I must protect hope. Hope, the Bible says in 1 Corinthians 13, tells us the love chapter. Now, all these spiritual gifts, all these things, all will pass away, but the greatest three things are faith, hope, and love. And the greatest of this is love. Hope is very important. Hope gives you the ability to cope. Without hope, it's very difficult to cope. And so we're given the hope when we're saved. If we already have something, we don't need hope for it. But if we look forward to something we don't have, we must wait patiently and confidently. You see, the biblical word of hope here in the Greek does not mean like we do. What? Yeah, I hope it doesn't rain anymore. When we say hope, it's kind of a loose term. I hope the food's good at McDonald's. It's not. Oh, I'm sorry. McDonald's is great food. All right. I hope the Yankees win next year. Okay, it's a loose thing. But biblical hope is not the same. Biblical hope is a confident expectation of a future fact. That is biblical hope. And that will sustain you. That will inflate that raft on the sea of turmoil and difficulty. Hope floats. This is a movie, I think it was, but never lie like it. Hope floats. It's important. If you've lost hope, you can't cope, can you? So you and I need to work on the hope. We need to ask God, God, let the joy and the hope of my salvation just buoy me up. And the discouragement keeps getting hit with discouragement. How do we overcome? And this hope will not lead to disappointment, it says in Romans 5:5. Why? For we know, dearly, God loves us because he has given us the Holy Spirit to fill our hearts with his love. Hope will not lead to disappointment. So, you want to get over disappointments? Learn to cultivate the hope of God in your life. How do you do that? You do it by reading his word, by getting around other believers, reminding yourself of the truth, retraining your brain, protecting your heart. For we know how clearly God loves us because he has given us the Holy Spirit to fill our hearts with his love. Now back to Romans 8. And the Holy Spirit helps us in our weakness. See, God did not leave you alone. He sent you the Holy Spirit. If you've given your life to Christ, you have the Holy Spirit in you. For example, we don't know what God wants us to pray, but the Holy Spirit prays for us with groanings that cannot be expressed in words. What does that mean? I believe it's very clear that often the Holy Spirit will groan inside of us. And sometimes you're like, oh, I don't even know. We believe that, you know, praying in the Spirit's a gift that I encourage you all to pursue. Well, you just, I don't even know what to say, God. I'm beyond words. And you just groan. Oh, God, I don't even know what to say. And the Spirit of God will begin to pray for you. God has installed in your life a general contractor. And that general contractor is called the Holy Spirit. He knows what you need. Okay, we need some drywall here in his life. Lord, we need some soldering. We need some metal pipes here. They got broken. See, the general contractor of your life is the Holy Spirit. He knows what you need. And so the Spirit of God asks God to send more of himself to you. So the Holy Spirit prays for us with groanings that cannot be expressed in words. How many of you have been to the place you don't even know how to express it? I don't know what to say. Sometimes the best thing to do is say nothing. Say, God, that's just how I feel. And the Father, who knows our hearts, knows what the Spirit is saying. For the Spirit pleads with us, believers, in harmony with God's own will. So God will take what's going on in your life, and he'll get it in your will. And we know that God causes everything to work together. Now, can you imagine Pronny Prossen there? He's in the morgue. He's sitting there probably reading, thinking this scripture verse, and God causes everything to work together for good. Yeah, so 6 weeks in a dark morgue with decomposing bodies. He said he was beside himself. He didn't know what to do. He was so discouraged. He's just like, God, why did you send me here? God, what are you? And all of a sudden, while he was praying out to God, the verse came to him, and they counted it joy that they could suffer with Christ in the book of Acts. He heard that verse, and something came alive in him. He said, yes, I get to fellowship in the sufferings of Christ. Thank you, God. And something happened. Something switched in his brain. He went from despair to hope. You know what he began to do? He began to see supernaturally. He saw scriptures in his mind. He could read passages of scriptures. So guess what Pronny Prossen did all day long? He started to preach to the dead bodies. You think he's a preacher in New England, okay? He was preaching to the dead bodies. And he was preaching day in, day out, day in. He was composing scriptures, composing sermons, preaching to dead cadavers. And every day, what would happen, the light would go on in that little slit in the door, and it would be on a little longer every day as the food came in. 1 minute was 1 minute, then it was 2 minutes, 3 minutes. And finally, every day, you saw the light being on longer and longer. And then one day, the door broke open. The prison guard went to his knees. What must I do to have your Jesus? It's a true story. The prison guard gave his life to Christ. The prison warder gave his life to Christ. And revival happened in that prison because a man named Pronny Prossen got hold of hope and got a hold of the Spirit of God. And God delivered him out of the misery of his set of circumstances. Why? He's still in the morgue. Same set of circumstances. It's not what happens to you. It's what happens in you. And so this is what happened. And the Spirit pleads with harmony with God's own will. We know that God causes everything to work together for good for those who love him and are called according to his purposes. And so the Bible says, for God knows in advance, he chose them to become like his son, so that in his son, the firstborn among them, made many brothers and sisters. And having chosen them, he called them to come to him. And having called, listen, you are not an accident. When you were in your mother's womb, God knew you. Before you were even formed, before God created the universe, he knew you would be here. You are not an accident. There might be accidental parents, but there's no accidental children. God has called every one of you, has a purpose and a plan that God wants to utilize you for. Guaranteed here. And having chosen them, he called them to come to him. And having called them, he gave them the right, standing with himself, And having given them the right standing, he gave him his glory. Now, this is really important. What shall we say about wonderful things as these? Listen, this is the hope we need to, cultivate this hope. If God is for us, who can ever be against us? I have overcome the world, since he did not spare even his own son, but gave him up for us. Won't he also give us everything else? Who dares accuse us whom God has chosen for his own? Listen, if you are a child of God and you feel accused, that's not of God. God will bring conviction, but not condemnation. Right. You can't do it. God's done with you. That's a lie from the enemy. God has called you, and you're here for a reason. You're here this morning for a reason. No one, for God himself has given us the right standing with himself. Why? Because of Jesus Christ in us, the hope of glory. Who then will condemn us? No one, for Christ Jesus died for us and was raised for life for us. And he's sitting in the place of honor at God's right hand, pleading for us. Do you know what happened? The first martyr in the church named Stephen, a young man who began to proclaim the gospel of Christ, and he was doing an amazing job. The Pharisees and the different religious community took stones and began to throw stones at him. He was being killed. And as stones were being thrown at him, he began to see Jesus on the right-hand side of God. Hope rose up in him to a level where he transcended his circumstances because the hope of Christ. And as he was being stoned, and as he saw the glory of God, it says, the glory of God was on his face. The Apostle Paul gathered his clothes, and the Apostle Paul was haunted by that man. And on their way, God met the Apostle Paul. And part of that was because of Stephen. Stephen transcended what happens. Not what happens to you, it's what happens in you through Christ. And so it says here, can anything ever separate us from Christ's love? Does it mean he no longer loves us if we have trouble? Some of you thinking, I got trouble, man. I got trouble. He must not love me anymore. He must have forgotten me. No. If we have trouble or calamity or persecuted or hunger or destitute, or in danger, or threatened with death. Listen, we don't have a lot of this going on right here in America, but you go to Iran, you go to Saudi Arabia, you go to different places in India with radical not only Islam, but radical Hindus, there's persecution going. They drag a body out and kill you. This is happening in Iraq right now. This stuff is happening, folks, because we don't experience it. We better get right and begin to build our spiritual muscles, because, you know, time could come where the whole planet could go in turmoil and the end days could be coming. We should be ready. We have trouble, calamity, or persecution, or hungry, or destitute, or in danger of threatening with death. As the scripture says, for your sake, we're being killed every day. We're being slaughtered like sheep. I mean, talk about difficult time. No, despite all these things, overwhelming victory is ours through what? Christ who loved us. Listen, we need to cultivate this love. This is what Prani Prasin did. He was in a morgue. He was destitute, 6 week complete darkness, decomposing bodies. Yet he found the hope of Christ, and it elevated him and brought him to a new place. Though he was imprisoned, he was set free. Some of you may have a good job and a good marriage, but you're blocked inside. God wants to set you free. And I am convinced that nothing can ever separate us from God's love. Neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither our fears for today or the election, nor our worries about tomorrow. Not even the powers of hell can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. Can I hear an amen about that this morning? Come on, everybody. No power in the sky above or in the earth below, indeed nothing in all creation, will ever be able to separate us from the love of God that is revealed in Christ Jesus our Lord. Listen, let's elevate hope. Let's build hope up. Learn to encourage yourself with who you are in Christ. Now, if you have sins in your life, you have things going on, it's time to get right with God. It's time to build hope, protect hope. Disappointments are going to come. Difficulties are going to come. This is not heaven. All creation groans. But rejoice, for I have overcome the world. And so we don't, listen, you have to shoot beyond this world to get through this world. I want to encourage you today that dealing with disappointment, for God works all things together for good for those that love God and are called according to his purposes. You can overcome. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, I want to thank you so much for your word. Lord, I thank you for your word that teaches us the truth. And Lord, I just pray for anyone right now that's going through a horrific time, those watching online or live or later, those right here, right now, God. We thank you for the hope in Christ Jesus is real. And Lord, we need your hope. We need your grace in our lives. And we ask for it today. With every head bowed, I'm going to ask you a question. Have you actually given your life to Jesus? You see, this only works if you give your life to Christ. You can never be good enough. You can't do enough good things. The only way we have access to God is through what Jesus Christ did on the cross. He paid for all your sins and my sins. And because he paid for it, you have access to God if you receive Jesus Christ and what he's done for you. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to pray a prayer right now. If you'll pray this in your heart and believe in your heart, then today can be your day where you know you are right with God. So I'm going to pray a prayer. I want to pray quietly in your own heart. Lord Jesus, I thank you for dying on the cross for me. I recognize that I am a sinner. I've turned away from you. I've done it my own way. I choose this day to turn away from the sin I know. I ask you to forgive me of all of my sins, both known and unknown. And I choose the best I know how to give my life to you. I declare that you are God and I'm not. I give my life to you today. Take me. Have your way in me. Give me the strength I need. Thank you that I am now a child of God. With every head bowed, say, Pastor, I prayed that prayer. Did anyone say, Pastor, do it quickly? Show of hands today, just so I know how to pray better for you. Give you some instructions. Thank you. Anyone else? Anyone else this morning? Thank you. Thank you. Okay, look up real quick. You'll see a card here. Listen to it. It says, my decision today. I've committed my life to Christ. I'm renewing my commitment to Christ. If you could fill that out, give it to some of the prayer team. The prayer team is going to make their way up in a few moments and put it into one of the boxes as you leave. We want to help you walk ahead. And I want to invite you to come to step one, how to connect to God, follow God. It's all about that today, how you have a vibrant life. Oh, I forgot we have communion today. Thank you for reminding me, everybody. Let's go ahead and hand out the elements. We're going to conclude our time here today with communion. You know, the good news is this, folks. Jesus died on the cross for us. And by his stripes, we are healed. We are made right with him. And some of you maybe are going through a difficult time. I know you are. I mean, we all go through difficult times. I want to encourage you. The Bible says, as you see today approaching, encourage one another. One another happens in groups. If you're not in a group with other believers, you need to get in a group with other believers. Encourage one another as you see the day approaching, it says in Hebrews. The day is approaching, is it not? And sometimes you might find yourself in difficult sets of circumstances, which is like your day approaching. How do we deal with it? We deal with it through the body of Christ, connected to Christ. In Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, just before he was betrayed, he took the bread, he broke it. So this is my body, which has been broken for you. Do you realize that Jesus was broken so we could be whole? Jesus understands brokenness. He understands betrayal. He understands anxiety. He understands abandonment. Jesus was in our skin and took on our sin so we can know his grace. And so I don't know where you are today, but I want to encourage you right now. We want to lift, everyone has an opportunity. We want to just lift the element that represents the bread of Christ, the body of Christ. I'm going to pray right now. Father, in Jesus' name, I ask right now that you'd heal bodies right now, people that are sick in body. We pray for those that are struggling with depression and broken relationships. Lord, we're asking right now, because you are broken, we're made whole. And Father, we thank you for that. And Jesus says, take, eat. This is my body, which has been broken for you. After they supped, Jesus took the wine. and saying, this is the new way of doing things. It's called a new covenant, new agreement. And what makes it happen? It's the blood of Jesus Christ who died for us, who paid for all of our sins. And that every day we can apply his blood to what? To forgive us of our sins and to bring healing to our relationships and our bodies. Take it and drink it, buddy. Let's all stand if we could. I'm going to ask the prayer team to make their way down. We're going to sing, Christ is Enough for Me. As we do that, you need prayer for any reason at all. We want to be able to pray with you. Listen, sometimes you need someone just to kind of come in agreement with you, right? If you fill that card out, we ask you to put it one, either one of the prayer team or one of the boxes. Let's sing that song, Christ is Enough for Me. Today. Come on. Yes, let's declare it. Christ is enough. May God bless you today. May you walk in his power and his grace. And let's, Lord, I ask for hope to rise in our hearts and our bodies and our minds, and that we would overcome through you, Jesus. Amen. God bless you. We're going to leave the front open for you guys if you want prayer. Otherwise, we dismiss you. God bless you. Love to see you at Grove Track. God bless you.